Hello, everybody. Welcome to rebranding of the Horn Guys. Intertwined with, he's basically a division of this, is with Low Brass Works and HornChic.com. We have some very exciting people here today. Obviously, we're here to celebrate Jim Self's 80th birthday. And I heard from a little rabbit that John has a birthday coming up himself. So they decided that because they're the same age, they wanted to play together forever. And they've made a few albums, individually and both together. We're celebrating Jim today and his 22 albums, Jim? Last time I talked to you, it was 20, now it's 21.
22 almost.
I think he just got back from Pennsylvania.
Right.
Recording his last album. So that's very exciting. We're really happy you're here to celebrate his birthday. And we have some nice songs that we're going to be performed today to kind of commemorate the open house of the Horn Guys intertwined with an online business, more or less, of HornChic.com as well as LowBrassWorks.com. As we know, we're available for appointment only. Today is a very special occasion where we've opened it up to purchasing and to celebrating Jim's birthday, and I think that's about it. Now Jim's going to play some songs, and in between you can ask questions. Please grab a chair if you'd like. You don't have to stand. There's chairs if you find them. Just make yourself comfortable. Grab a drink. There's beer from Don Pueblo Brewing, some non-alcoholic beverages, some tacos, and I guess get ready to enjoy the music. We have Michael Stern here to audio engineer it, and then my friend OC from It's a Song Called Life is a podcast that's really doing some exciting things in the industry, which he's already podcasted and had an interview with Jim himself. So you'll have to ask about that. But no further ado, let's get on to performance time. Enjoy Mr. Jim Self and his birthday.
Thank you.
Songs, it just kind of lays well on the tuba. And if you haven't met John Chiodini, this is my partner. We've been playing together for seven years or something like that. We met on the Dave and Angel Band, which is a 13-piece band that we both play on. And one day I said, I love guitar. I always have. I was a bad guitar player when I was a boy. And I became, like a lot of bad guitar players, they become bass players. So I made a lot of money doing that in the early years of my career. But John and I just said, let's get together and play some tunes. And we've been playing almost every Friday for 7 years at my house. It just turned into a way more than a musical partnership. We've become super good friends. We're only 40 days apart in age. He's the young one, now, damn it. Speaking of which, this is my 80th birthday last Sunday. I never thought I would make it. I'm happy to be here with my wife, Jamie, who is having her 90th birthday. Doesn't she look great for 90?
Yeah, amazing.
Now, recently, women don't like to talk about their age usually. She turned about 80 or 85 and she still looked good, so she started bragging about the other women. And now, so everybody's impressed, as we all are. She's a wonderful lady and supports my whole crazy career and life and everything else. We've been together 40 some years now, right? 42, okay, yeah. What I thought I would do is play another song, and then we'll open it up to a few things. We'll play a couple more songs later, whatever feels comfortable for everybody, okay? And I'm open to questions at some point. I'll say you can sort of lead after that. I'll come back after. I mean, we'll do one more tune. We're going to do Chick Corea, Spain.
Yes, very nice, very nice.
Thank you.
Oh, by the way, this is on the fluba. Let me see. Yes.
I brought my fluba with me, which is this is the only one in captivity, by the way. It was made by Rob Stewart, the great brass maker here. And you tuba players and you brass enthusiasts, most of you, I want you to look at it here. It's a It's originally made from a compensating, the valve set is made from an old Yamaha valve set that he cut down to F. Because I like to play an F when I just, my mind goes there in the right way. And then we put a small Yamaha F tuba bell, and he made this beautiful taper. And anyway, it's a really unique instrument, and he's not making any more, so if anybody wants one, they have to get somebody else to build it for them. But it's, for some reason, when I play it, I pretend I'm an art farmer or one of those great flugelhorn players. I know I'm not.
But you're a great flugelhorn player.
Flugelhorn, yeah.
And if you have any questions in the Zoom as well, please feel free to write that in the chat. And I see one over there, I will take a look at it for sure.
Okay, John. You ready?
Yeah. Oh, Standard tune, yeah. Based on
the tuba.
Well, not on the tuba, but I've been playing it for years. I even have a big band arrangement that I played. But we recorded. You'll see some of my albums around here. John and I have made three duo albums, and we did one with the David Angel Band, and we just did an album called My America 2, which is all American songs. I think they're all in the office there, and. This is one of the ones we like to do with the fluba, okay? The fluba is a unique instrument, you know. And believe it or not, Bob Sanders sitting back here, one of my best friends, he knows he sat right next to me when we played it with Pacific Symphony on Petrushka, the bare solo I played on this thing, two different times. Two different guest conductors, two different years, and it was the best I've ever played it, to be honest. I was more secure on it than I was on the tuba, but not too many conductors probably would go for that. The sound goes, of course, out to the audience. That's the main difference between that and the tuba. When you hear it on the recordings, I mix up the songs with fluba and tuba, but it's hard to tell the difference because it's me playing, plus it's whichever way you're playing into the microphone. So you have to look at the notes to do it. But I want to introduce Osita Akitpoh here, who's going to make a few comments and sort of moderate our concert here.
Yeah. Cool. Hello, everyone. My name is Osi. I am a tuba player here in LA, and I host a podcast, as mentioned before. That piece you guys just played by Chick Corea. Correct me if I'm wrong, I think he passed like earlier this year or maybe late last year, something like that. So yeah, rest in peace to a legend, but I love that track. But yeah, I'm really excited to be here at the Horn Guys. In fact, I am so excited that I went to the old location first just to soak up the past and the present and, you know, definitely the future of this place. But yeah, no, I'm really happy to be here and honored to here, let me not block the man of the hour here. Yeah, be here with Jim and celebrate his birthday. Just a few words about this guy. I had him on my podcast as a guest, and Jim's a really busy guy, and I was like, you know what, like, hopefully we can get about an hour to talk, and you gave me like 3.5. It was a long conversation, but you've lived an even longer life. So, I think we just scratched the surface, but I think today, having the opportunity to pick your brain, learn more about you and all the awesome things you've done in your career, I think we could all, everyone here could learn something. So, if you'd like to play another track and then we can continue.
Let's just start now.
Sure, yeah. So, actually, I'm just curious how many brass players there are here, just in general. Brass. Okay. Well, that makes sense. Yeah. I didn't expect anyone to go, I'm like, no, we're all pianists, but. and I'm guessing mostly low brass, tuba? Okay. Yeah, I mean, trombone, can't forget those guys. But I see multiple generations of tuba players here, and you've always been known for bringing people together. With a beautiful home like that, it would be a crime not to, but you're a pillar of the community, you're always bringing people together, today being an example. And I think my question for you, and we'll open it up to people, for you is just, I think the best question I can ask right now is just what keeps you going, you know, so.
Hello, okay, technology. what keeps me going? A lot of people ask me that, and it's a great bit of it is knowing this man right here. He's inspired me, he's changed my life. All of a sudden I'm allowed to be a tuba soloist, if you will, and to develop my chops as a jazz improviser, and he just gives me great advice, plus he's willing to play with me all the time. If you can find a person like that, any person, a pianist there that, an accompanist of some sort or something, just or somebody just to play duets with, hold on to them, keep them close, because these are the people that inspire you and make you get, I don't know how much, I just turned 80, so. I don't know what's going on with the rest of my life. When you get to be this age, you get thinking about the end of the game, and you wonder how you're going to fill it up and stay healthy. That's a tough one, by the way. Staying healthy. There's lots of issues that come up when you get older. You can't handle things as well and as quickly. But I find that growing as a musician. I'm still growing. I've been a student my whole life, and I'm still a student. And listening to great musicians, and I do have the good fortune of playing with four orchestras here in Los Angeles, and they're all very first class. The LA Opera, the Pacific Symphony, the Pasadena Symphony, the Hollywood Bowl Orchestra, and those are just full of great musicians, and in fact our whole town, as you all know, is full of great musicians that come from all the other places around the country, and we live off of each other in some way, we inspire each other. When I go on a studio call, I don't do so much of that anymore, but I had a heck of a good run. I'm in John Williams, be on a session with John Williams. Every chair is full of is a giant musician. The fourth flute is a fine player, you know what I mean? And you rarely hear any mistake, whether it's a solo or whether it's super technically difficult. And you can't be anything but inspired when you're around people like that. And the same with the conductors that we have and I do a lot of opera. I never thought I would do any opera to speak of, and all of a sudden they needed a tuba player when the opera company started, and I was sort of the hot guy in town, I guess, and so I didn't have to audition for this job, so in the future, the people who replace me are going to have to audition. It's a whole new thing, but anyways, I've done dozens and dozens of operas, including the whole Ring cycle, and I never knew that would be part of my life. But what I enjoy most of all is improvising and jazz and composing. I tell my students that when I was 20, roughly 20, I knew the only art in music was in composing and improvising. Those are the two sides of the same coin, by the way. Something told me that I want to go there in my life somehow. But I can't be a Mozart, I can't think of a symphony in my head. I write it down, so I didn't. I wasted 30 years of my life, really. But during that period, I also worked hard at jazz, and all of a sudden I had stuff in my head. not whole symphonies or anything like that. But I started writing when I was almost 50 years old. And that's 30 years ago now. And I've written almost 100 pieces for orchestra, band, chamber music, jazz, all kinds of stuff. And so that, along with trying to play jazz, is what inspires me, Aussie.
And another, you know, just while you were speaking, it made me think of, I think my very first time interacting with you was over the phone, because I think I was 17 at the time, and I was thinking about, you know, where I wanted to go for undergraduate, my undergraduate degree. I was in Baltimore, and USC has the faculty, like, the cell phone numbers on their pages. I was like, all right, I'm going to call this guy. And I called him, and I think this is just another example of just how generous of a person you've been to me, is that, like, you had no idea who I was. You picked up the phone and gave me about like a half hour of your time just explaining, like, what it's like to be a student here, if it would be getting to know my situation and seeing if it would be work for me. You had no idea who I was, who I studied with, like, and I was, unfortunately I couldn't come. I ended up going to school near me, but then I came out for a lesson about 4 years later, and of course, you know, I was prepared for an hour lesson. I think you gave me two that day. It was a highlight of my trip here, because I was just here visiting, and I say that because I think, though you've had a very amazing career as a performer, I think you've had an equally amazing career as an educator because of the amount of people that you have and careers that you've touched. I don't know a single tuba player in this town who doesn't have a story about how you in some type of way lifted them up. And I can tell that legacy and community is really important to you. That's why you have foundations that you donate to, things that then uplift young brass players as well. So clearly what comes after you is extremely important to you. And I just think that's something to commend. But I guess on that note, a question would be, I guess did you always have this sense of community in mind, or at some point in your career did you realize that you were this pillar of the community and made it like your responsibility to help other players?
Well, I one of the things that I'm so fortunate to have is I have a music ed degree. I was going to be a band director, and I get out of college, the only job paid $4,000 a year, and I luckily went to a U.S. Army band concert. And I went backstage and asked the principal, too, is there any openings? He said, yeah, come down and audition. So I went to Washington and auditioned, and it changed my life. Instead of becoming a teacher, I mean, I have always been a teacher, but like a public school teacher, I became a player. And that changed everything. I got my master's degree there in Washington, and the Army paid for it. And while I was doing it, I got to go to New York City and study with Harvey Phillips, who was the greatest tuba player in the world at the time. And said he was my teacher there. And after I came to Los Angeles, I studied with Tommy Johnson here. And he was the West Coast Harvey Phillips, if you know what I mean, the best out here and the most amazing studio musician that ever lived, and a wonderful teacher and everything else. I also got to study with Roger Bobo. All three of those guys were the top of the business, very top. And so part of me wanted to be like them as much as I could. And I, particularly when I came to LA, I was scared as hell to come here, because you all know what the competition is and what the odds are of you getting work. Well, came at the right time in the 70s when there was a lot of television, and Tommy helped me a heck of a lot getting gigs. And, to have those three guys as my inspiration is, I hope I can pass some of that on. One of the things I wanted to be able to do was to play in the sandbox with Roger and Tommy here in Los Angeles. They were almost superhuman musicians, you know. You ever hear them play together at the Philharmonic, you know what I'm talking about. It was something else. There's some cool records out there about it too. But so if I passed anything on as a teacher, it's because I was influenced by the best. I don't know how else to put it. In my opinion, the best people of their generation. And I wanted to pass along and be part of my generation, and then the guys like Doug and Norm and other people who studied with me, Blake here, all these guys, there's so many people that, and even Steve Ferguson studied with me some when he was at SC. Many of you were some of my students, so I guess I've touched a lot of people, and I'll never be as good as those other three guys, but I think I can play in the sandbox with them.
Well, I could ask you a million questions, but this is not about me. I would like to open it up, maybe first start off with anybody in here, and yeah.
Yeah, there are a lot of people in this room. If you ask them, what point were you able to step up your musicianship and your tuba playing, what point did that happen? And a number of people would say a lesson with himself. So what was your point where you were able to take a step up in your musicianship and your artistry and your tuba? When did that happen? In college or school or afterwards professionally?
Like I said, I got into U.S. Army Band in 1965, and I get there, and Dan Parentoni was there in the tuba section. This was Vietnam wartime, and we were all trying to stay out of the war because we got drafted in those days. Chester Smits, who became the great tuba player with the Boston Symphony for 35 years, he was there too. We were all in the band together. And those guys, right away, knocked me over how good they were. And I wanted to try to do so. I did my very first recital at Catholic U when I was a master's student, studying with Harvey Phillips. And I did a whole bunch of recitals in those days, and all through my years as a college professor. At University of Tennessee for 5 years, and then out here I did a doctor's degree at USC with Tommy, and I did a bunch of recitals for that. So that put me in a strong classical thing, you know, and of course I played a lot of chamber music too, and taught chamber. I taught brass quintets forever at USC, and a lot of some of you were in my groups, and I don't do it anymore. I must say that. I have announced that this is my last year at USC, 48 years. So I'm just not leaving town. I'm going to be around, and I'm going to help Doug and whatever else goes on down there as much as I can. But I'm going to spend a little more time composing and improvising, and maybe I'll be available for more teaching too on a private level. So but that's the thing. I'm going to play another song for you right now, okay? John and I are going to play a ballad by Ralph Ranger. It's called Easy Livin'. Oh.
I did want to say something about John. His name is spelled Chiodini, but in Italian it's Chiodini. Took me a while to get used to that, but I want to tell you a little bit about John. He's everybody's favorite accompanist. Every singer that I know in Los Angeles has played with him. He did the world tour with Natalie Cole, went all over the world with a great band, and he was with Peggy Lee for many years. Before that, he was with Maynard Ferguson and played kind of a fusion band. He has a wonderful album made back in the 80s, kind of a fusion jazz album himself with original music. And he's recorded so many other, particularly singers. They love him because you can tell the way he accompanies. He's, like I say, you can get somebody that can make you sound good like that, hold on to him. So I hold them pretty tight. We happen to be history buffs. We're also very much akin politically and socially and even religiously in some ways, aren't we? We have good philosophies that are very similar. So it's way more than just a musical friendship. So anyway, Easy Living is one of my favorite songs. It just flows good for me. So
I'm gonna put some of the young guys on the spot just because you guys look a little young, you know. And I think back in the day, I think, you know, being in the presence of someone like Jim, I think there's like a lot of the road between like being, you know, 18 or 21 and then someday maybe achieving something like what Jim has achieved, it kind of seems like almost unbelievable, but then you learn it's a little bit more practical. You just have to, you have to be consistent. Most of all, you have to love what you do. But anyway, I say all that just because I'm just curious if any of the younger players in the room have, like, do you guys have any thoughts or questions? Just wondering, how does someone get to this point, you know? Yeah, I mean that's a giant question, but I think maybe to, like, you know, give you some direction. I think you do a lot of things that people that I wouldn't consider to be obvious to do on the tuba and make a living out of it. Whether that's doing sort, you know, genres that people would normally say, oh, tuba's not a part of that, or you know. Instrumentation that people don't usually see, but I think you've had this kind of fearless way of making music as a tuba player that definitely knocked down, you know, barriers that maybe most of us as tuba players put up ourselves, and you just seem to never see those. But maybe that's a good place to go from in terms of how did you get here.
Well, I mentioned I studied with Harvey and Tommy and Roger. Those guys were innovators, all of them in their own way. I mean, Roger Bobo's first album scared the world. It was so impressive, avant-garde. It was allowed to be played on the tuba. So range, he had like a 4-octave range or something that's just scared the heck out of all of us. And from that point on in the mid-60s, the rest of us had to get better if we wanted to play in the game. And of course, Tommy, here in LA, became the great studio player because he was a good soloist. He had a good sound, he was musical. And before him, the tuba players weren't as good. There were some decent players, don't get me wrong, but they didn't have that solo quality. And all of a sudden, people were writing solos in Jaws and movies like that. And one of the things that anybody who studied with me knows that I insist on them learning songs. Songs to me are the basis of being a good musician. And also, you need to get an identity with your instrument. Just you and the horn. When I sit here and play by myself, I'm scared to death in a way. On another level, I'm not a religious guy, but I'm one with God. I'm one with the world. Because there's nothing else between me and my horn. That's my voice now. Now, what I tell students, I say, play Happy Birthday for me. Most of them can't do it. Tuba players, young people. Why? Because they never did. Nobody ever told them to do it. The trumpet players get to play, you know, they get to play melodies, you know, and violinists and so on, pianists. But we don't. So I insist on that. I think we need to get into that more. I think it's made me a better player. And I think it's made a lot of my students a better player. And at least they're aware of it. And if you want to succeed in the studio business today, like Doug and Blake and Gary and some of the other guys that are here, you got to be able to play the solo. And you also have to double. You have to play bass trombone, maybe. Or you have to play chimbassos. And that's all part of the game of being a studio musician. And it's become very sophisticated over the years. And I've often used an analogy. I don't know whether I could prove this or not, but I could take the top 10 tuba players in America, major symphony players, famous people, great tuba players, ask them to play the Star Spangled Banner with no mistakes in rhythm. I'd be lucky to get two. Think about that. The melody. I'm not talking about playing an oompah bass part. I'm talking about playing the melody. Why?
Everyone has sung it thousands of times. They never make a mistake when they sing, and they never think about it making a mistake. They never even imagine making a mistake when they sing. Same with Happy Birthday or Row, Row, Row Your Boat or any other song that they know. This is where I want tuba players to get to closer as a student and as a moving ahead to be a better player. I know that that influence that Tommy and Harvey and Roger gave me some big breaks, particularly with John Williams. A movie came along in 19, I had of course done the Close Encounters thing because it's a studio story. Tommy was on vacation and I get this great call. It turned out to be the biggest thing that ever happened in the tubas, but for tuba in the movies. But Tommy was still his tuba player for several more years. 1990 came along and they did the movie Home Alone, which was a huge, huge success, you know. Well, it had a bunch of tuba solos in it, and he asked for me for that movie because he had heard several of my albums by that point. And he knew that I could be jazzy or whatever it took. And from that point on, I was his tuba player for 25 years. And wow, what an influence that man has been on my life. And again, I feel so fortunate, but it's because I had a solo quality that I could put on, let alone you have to play the part. You can't make mistakes. If you're a studio musician, and if you're playing, there's four trombone players sitting next to you and you're on a John Williams call and there's one 4-4 bar where there's a short, loud note on the 4th 16th of the third beat of a 4-4 bar. You can't be a little bit early or a little bit late. The trombones can make it speak much quicker than a tuba. You got to be on top of it, so you have to be able to attack in the right place, so your rhythm has to be perfect. And I've put a lot of thought into that, and I worked hard at it all my life. I also got to play with Don Ellis when I was young. Don, when I first came to town, I was in his last band. Everything he wrote was in odd meters. So I learned to sight read odd meters pretty good, and that happens all the time in studio work. I mean, you just get used to it. You also get used to grooves. Like a samba has a feel. A bass line. I did a whole Latin album with guys from the Poncho Band, my own album. It's called Yo. And just working with these real authentic, you know, Afro-Cuban musicians made me better in that field, and I learned from it. But I make projects for myself that take me to a new level.
Yeah, going off of what you just said, I think it would be fair to, you know, almost call you an entrepreneur or a businessman that just happens to play the tuba, in the sense that something I picked up from you in our podcast conversation was that I feel like you looked at playing and being a performer and, you know, things like practicing and being good at what you do is almost the bare minimum, because something that you stressed was that you wanted to make sure that you were reliable to the people that you worked for. And I'm sure, you know, John Williams, I'm sure he loves the way that you sound, but it's not just the playing that makes you John Williams go-to tuba guy. And I think for young players, whether on Zoom or really anybody here, in terms of like, it's one thing to get to that level as a musician, but then to get to that level where you're establishing relationships with all sorts of people and across all sorts of mediums of music, I think in many ways it's fair to call you an entrepreneur. So maybe if you want to touch on just how you did that.
Well, I mentioned I studied Harvey Phillips. Well, once I was his student for a year or so, and he left, went to Boston, and he went to Indiana and taught, and he started so many things in the tuba world. Tuba Christmases all over the world, commissioned hundreds and hundreds of works of music and performed them and recorded them. He was a businessman. He was an entrepreneur's exact word that he would use for himself. And he says that we musicians, particularly we freelance musicians, we have to sell ourselves. Now, that's sometimes an ego thing, you know. You've got to be careful. You don't want to come off as being too proud of yourself and everything. But you got to sell your music. You got to sell what you do. And the only way to do it is to make a record and go out and play for you guys here or something. You know, I guess I'm selling myself in some way. And maybe I'm a little bit beyond the age limit now where my future is going to be as full as my past has been. But it's still going to be cool. I know that. I just know it. And I don't know if anybody else has any other questions.
So you taught your students to listen to tunes and learn tunes, and then they want to improvise. What's the next step for you to learn and teach them how to learn some vocabulary so they have riffs to play and ideas to play in these tunes they're learning? Do you have some tips for that? How to go from sheet music reader to creating stuff in your head?
It's not an easy thing. I played a gig for a whole year on string bass and a little bit of tuba with John Henry, a great jazz singer of the 60s and 70s. And I was playing string bass, and every once in a while they'd give me a salute. It was called Evolution of the Blues. They were playing blues. And every time I tried to play a solo, I was stepped all over it. So I just stopped doing it because I was playing with these great players and I didn't want to be embarrassed. But I went home after that gig was over, a whole year of work. And I said, I'm going to commit 25 years to becoming a good jazz player on the tuba, because that's my instrument, not the bass. And so I did. And over those 25 years, I made a bunch of albums. And each one took me to a new level. And each one I keep making now in the future takes me to a new place. That's how you learn. You, by putting the project in front of you that's too hard for you at the moment, and you practice to get to there or whatever you have to do to achieve it. It's true with getting a doctor's degree. That ain't easy. But you gotta, once you do it, I have a kind of a motto I live with. It's maybe corny, but it's my motto. It's how I live, and I think it works for most people. Do what you say you're gonna do. Finish what you start. If you do those two things, the people sitting next to you, the people you communicate with, they respect you because they can trust you. Those things work for me. I think they work for most everybody. You gotta be a good person, you know. You can't be a asshole and be a, make it in a freelance world, for sure, right? And by the way, Doug Tornquist is John Williams' tuba player now. And I think he's down with Doug's still here or not, but he's, in 2015, they came back to with the Star Wars films to America. And they changed all the principal brass players, me and Malcolm and Jim Thatcher and Bill Booth, but Bill got back on, but the rest of us, I played a second tuba with Doug several times, and I couldn't be more proud, because he was a student of mine. He got his doctorate at USC and studied with me and Tommy, and he's earned it. He's paid the dues, and I really appreciate that in our freelance business. You just come, you know, if you're just an overnight wonder and you happen to get all the great gigs, and it's not fair to all the people that worked hard for years. So, if you know, if there's any justice in that, anyway.
More questions? I don't want to forget about the people we have on the Zoom. I'm not sure if.
That's a big deal. There's a couple questions I asked, actually. Yes. Standing. Okay. Question for Jim. Yes.
Thank you so much for your questions on Zoom. We have a question from Zachariah for Jim about standing versus sitting. What are breathing preferences from one to the other?
Is that Zach Spellman?
Yeah. Yes.
Zach's my buddy. Zach is a tuba player in the San Francisco Opera. And I used to go up there, and I used to be a pilot, and I used to fly up there and hang out with him. And
Zach's album, we have in stock, and he's so modest, he wouldn't even put his name on it.
He is a very modest guy, that's for sure, but he's a wonderful musician and a super nice person. Anyway, what was the question again?
So standing versus sitting, what are the breathing preferences?
Well, you know, I used to stand a lot when I played jazz with a strap, the thing I called my tuba off. But it's a little harder for me now that I'm older. I hurt my back kind of this morning to lose. So I like to stand. I played concertos that way. I played played the Vaughan Williams that way one time. There's something about standing. I kind of move, and most people, the soloists, do stand in front of an orchestra, but it does free up your breathing. But it may cause other problems for you, backache with a tuba. I don't have a preference exactly for it, you know, but now that I'm old as the hills, I think it's better to sit down most of the time, so. Any more questions?
Thank you for that. We have another question from Eric Fritz, and there is a question again for Jim. Can you tell us about your daily routine over the years to keep your basic skills going while playing so many gigs and calls? Is there specific etude books, scales, or routines that you would recommend, etc.?
Well, this is where I differ from most people. Eric is another great. He went to USC also, and he plays in Mexico, a fine orchestra in Mexico, and went to Juilliard after he left here. He's quite the guy. Anyway, I do not have a daily routine, and it probably has hurt my playing in some way. I think you should have one. I think you should have a warm-up routine.
Huh? What's hurt your playing exactly, Jim?
Well, sometimes I'm not as... One of the things, for 40 years, I worked almost every day in the studios. And I didn't have to practice much to stay in good shape. Because I was playing all the time. And plus, when you do recording work, you walk in, you don't have time to warm up. And one of the things you don't want to do is sit there and noodle a lot in front of Malcolm McNabb and Bill Booth and these other guys. It's just not cool. So you do your warm-up at home if you're going to do it, and if you start doing that, people don't like it. And I won't talk about some stories, but I have some stories about it with other people. But I do think you should have a routine, certainly to get warmed up. And if you are working every day like I did, some of these guys here are working down at Disney. They got iron chops from playing sousaphone. But they probably have to practice to be sensitive to play in a quintet or to play a solo piece. Because when I played a lot of sousaphone, I found that it's hard. You know, same with doubling, bass trombone and stuff. I know several guys that got vocal dystonia going back and forth from. Maybe going back and forth from trombone and tuba and Broadway shows and things. And so you be careful with those kind of things. When I play a bass trombone, I use a tuba rib mouthpiece, which is not kosher, but it's great for low notes. Kind of terrible for high notes, but it's gotten me through years and years of studio gigs, and I don't have much of this either. So I'll leave it to the trombone player. They all know how bad or how good I am, so I'll leave it at that. Doubling is important. More questions?
There's actually wondering, Elaine was wondering if you would consider doing a song request at all today, because she would love to hear the title track from Hanging Out. Do you two have that at all under your...
We
don't have that one memorized. Maybe there's a couple. You want to give a couple options?
Well, we're going to play another tune for sure. Okay. But maybe a couple more. What do we do? The Girl from Ipanema. Okay. Bossa Nova.
Girl from Ipanema, Bossa Nova, is coming up, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you again for being here.
And we're going to play the Basset and Hound Blues later.
Get ready for some Basset and Hound Blues.
Better get your howls ready.
Get your howls ready, everyone.
So here we go.
In the 60s with Charlie Bird and Astrid Gilberto and, you know, and Jobim.
Ah, Jobim.
And Stan Getz. They had a wonderful album in the early 60s. I fell in love with the bossa nova. And I've been in love with it my whole life. And John and I played a lot of bossa novas together, and both on our albums. And I just played them. I just love them. I love the feel. There's a bossa nova is a jazz samba. They're usually not as fast as a real samba, but there's a similar kind of a groove. And there's something about the way the guitar is used in bossa novas with the kind of voicings that John particularly is a master of. You asked me why I play with guitar. I've always looked for instruments that blend well with the tuba. The guitar does really well. And another instrument that blends very well is the harp. Another instrument is the vibraphone. And not piano so much, it's not bad, but it's not as good. Rhodes piano, electric piano. There's something about the quality of the sounds always blend well with the tuba. And so I've used those on all the other ones that I have. Two albums of the great passed away now, Ron Kalina, harmonica and tuba. And we have two great jazz albums we made 25 years apart. He's passed away now, but he was a virtuoso. And we even did Charlie Parker tunes, tuba and harmonica. So, because the sound was so good together. So, more questions?
There's a question here. Where's the question?
Well, right here.
Jesus. Oh, okay. Put your hands in front. Thank you.
Maestro, I'm aware that back in the days and even today, people don't tend to think of brass instruments as classical instruments so much. Wherefore, my question unto you is, did you grow up classically trained from day one of starting your tuba playing career?
Well, like most of us, I played guitar first, and I did play kind of a jazz style. I wasn't very good at it, but I played all through college and through high school. But they needed a tuba player in the junior high band, and so I played a Helicon tuba, and then I got pretty good on a tuba. I was an all-state band in Pennsylvania, so that's what I want. What are you going to do with your life when you're 18? Well, that's a big problem for you. So I decided to go be a band director. But as far as I grew up in a small town, and I didn't have much musical influence. I didn't hear a symphony live until I was a junior in college. The Pittsburgh Symphony came to my college. I never heard one. I wasn't even aware of Eastman, which is only 100 miles away from where I lived. My buddy Dan Parentoni went to Eastman. Somehow he heard about it, got in, and of course he had a great career. But I went to a small college because I was going to be a band director. But I didn't have much good influence musically as a young guy. Just the local town. Played in little firemen's bands and things like that, you know. I don't know whether I'm answering your question or not, but I picked up most of it as I came along the way, through colleges and through the U.S. Army Band and through all the great gigs I've done here and the symphonies I've played in and so on. And a tuba player has to be a good classical player. You're not going to make a living, very good one, playing jazz on the tuba. I make zero money playing jazz on the tuba, but
had more fun at it, more than anything. But the gigs are on symphonies, operas, ballets, some stuff like that. So you gotta be good at that. You need to study to get that way. Yeah.
So, any more there?
Don't forget the accordion too,
the
Dave said.
Oh yeah, I love the accordion. Actually, Frank Morocco was a great jazz accordion player here in Los Angeles that I played a lot with. One of the good things that happened to me, and Bob Sanders knows this a lot because we worked so many gigs together, it's when the tuba is used, it's often comedies or for fat people or for elephants, things like that. So, and somehow the accordion and the harmonica always seem to be in these same movies, you know, things like Bad News Bears, two movies like that, and I did a whole bunch of those kind of movies for different guys, and often the tuba solos is when there's some fat guy or some whale or some elephant in it. Okay, so is that all?
Karen wants to wish you a happy 80th.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Karen Hutchinson. No, nobody has any other questions on the chat so far.
Well, if there's nothing more, John and I want to play another tune, and then we'll call it a day. Does that sound good?
Yes, I think so.
And well, I want to thank you, and Steve, and the whole gang here for thinking about me and thinking about John and I. And I feel so blessed to be around you. And so, and my whole life has been around great musicians, and I thank you all for coming out today and for sharing this with me. Okay, it's my only 80th birthday. No more of these, okay, guys. Just come to when we play in a club or something. Please come out and hear us, okay? You're gonna hear it. I have a new quintet, some albums here with Ron Stout, the great flugelhorn player. You're gonna dig it. It's really cool. So we're gonna play our last song, and you gotta be part of the audience, okay? You're part of the band. Is that cool?
Yes.
All right. Years ago, I did an album with Pete Chrisley, tenor, great jazz tenor player, and I wrote a song called "The Basset Hound Blues." And if you know Jamie and I, we've had basset hounds forever, and we got the dog to howl, and I recorded it, and I wrote a song with these little breaks in it for the dog to howl. Of course, we've had to overdub them. But, and it's become sort of a trademark. My record label is called Basset Hound Records. We have a big music room at home we call Basset Hall. We have a house full of figurines, Basset figurines. And we don't have a dog now, but we had him for 50 years. And they're cool. You know why I like dogs? I think it's because they always act like they're stoned all the time. Right?
They do.
You know, Basset, you put your hand under his head, and pretty soon his whole head's in your hand, and then he gradually shrinks down to the floor. They know what relaxation is, okay? So, we're going to play the Basset Hound Blues, but you have to howl.
Okay.
But I don't have a dog. The dog, by the way, Stanley, our dog, he's on tour in Asia right now after his European tour. And he's doing the dog arias of Giacomo Puccini. Sorry. Okay. Now, here's the deal. I'll explain it without the mic.
Okay.
And you can feel free to take off your microphones if you want on Zoom, you know, to do the howling so we could have more,
okay,
more howling from all over the world.
Let me hear you howl. Ready?
Come on. Now, you girls have to get down. Because the basset hounds, even the female basset hounds, have low voices.
Okay, I'll get low.
Jared. Come on, Bob.
Okay, so I'm going to play the tune, and I'll show you. It's got about a 3-octave range in it, so it's kind of crazy. When I play, when I play pedal E flat, that's when you do your howl, okay? Happens. I'll try to give you a cue. If you don't know the song, now we'll play it twice through so you get a chance to do better the second time through, okay? So one, two, three, four. Buy my records, please.
any CD you buy today from Jim Self's album will be 100% donated to the Jim Self Foundation. We've got all of his new CDs in the other room. All CDs are $15. I will be checking out any items you want. Bill Reichenbach, I think, is the other one we have for sale, and we'll be donating the 100% of the proceeds for those CDs as well. Jim, I did have a question. I know we're done, but I wanted to ask you about musician etiquette and how you've been in this industry for so long, and you've been around so many different musicians, and you've always remained humble, excited, eager, and through all the bullshit that you know exists, how does one maintain this wonderful etiquette with professionalism mixed in with having fun and having a great attitude? And yeah, what's your few cents on that?
Well, I don't know whether it's part of my built-in personality or not, but I try to get along with people. I don't want politics or religion to get between my friends. I'll turn around and walk away before this crap comes up in my mind. You've got to be nice to that guy sitting next to you, that bass trombone player, maybe the next contractor. If you're not nice, or you smell bad, or something else, you know, that's part of etiquette too, I guess, you know. You just have to be a good person, and I guess you've got to get outside your own ego a little bit and think about the other person. I think that always works in life. If you share their feelings, let them talk a little bit, you know, don't go on and on. And there's quite a camaraderie amongst the low brass players and all brass players in Los Angeles. And going out to lunch on studio calls for years with the trombone players, I just got to know Dick Nash and Lloyd Ulliate and George Roberts and Bill Booth and on and on and on. And just some great, 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 great trombone players, you know, and we're all hanging out at lunch. And we're friendly, and that's, I don't know how else to put it. Just always be pleasant, you know. There are things that'll piss you off, there's no doubt about that. You just can't let them. Okay? Well, I used to be a pilot. I mean, you know, there's a lot of paranoia in the studio business. Why didn't I get this job? Why didn't so-and-so call me? Drives you nuts, especially after you get called for the last time. And so I used to be a pilot, which is godsend for me, because I go flying. When you're flying, you can't think of something else. It took my mind off all the crap, and it was a wonderful part of my life. But you have to find those ways to let the steam off, okay, baby. So, hope that answers your question.
Yes. No. Thank you.
Thank you for answering that. Any other questions before we, you know, let Jim pack up that anyone has about the industry, or questions you want to know about playing wise? Otherwise, Steve, would you like to say anything right this moment?
Sure.
Yeah, please. We would like to have Steve Ferguson, the owner of this incredible legacy shop for over 20-something years, to say a few words.
Thank you to everyone for coming, and thank you, Jim Self, my mentor for a very long time. You've had such a positive effect on all the business and dealings and humanity for so many years, so I appreciate that. And for coming here, I feel like I hired you for a gig, so see the contractor afterwards.
Good gig, thank you.
We talked a little bit about CDs, and for some people that's last year's kind of media, they're streaming, and I understand that. I put out a selection of CDs here in our small showroom because they're all by someone we know, or who is a mentor or teacher of ours, someone from LA. Take a look at the stack of CDs, because not all of those will be printed anymore. There's just a few left. And there's some greats, lots of CDs by Jim Self, Roger Bobo, Jeff Reynolds, Bill Reichenbach, Bill Roper, and on. Too many names for me to think. There's even one by Walt Johnson, trumpeter here. And it's a nice memory of past and sharing that with future generations. So CDs are a nice piece of history, and nobody has to buy anything today, but they're fun art to look at, and for some of these you support a good cause.
And so, they still sound better than MP3s.
Yes, quality
yes,
is better.
Thank you for saying that.
And if you haven't been upstairs, we have open showroom there with a lot of interesting German instruments out on display, and we have beer from the next door brewery, which is open now. If you want to try any of their beer taps, just go to the back of the parking lot and through the gate, and Martine will serve you freshly brewed beer. Also snacks here. And moving forward, the hours for this is internet anytime when that's working again, and in store, generally Mondays and Thursdays, call ahead. Thanks again, everybody, for being here. Thank you.
Excellent.